Woke up this morning, and life as you know it looks nothing like the kind of life you knew before. All of a sudden, fear stole the headlines, and it don't feel safe to even step outside your door. In this world, you will have trouble, but I have overcome the world. So take heart and take a breath. Let me lift that heavy weight up off your chest. And take my hand, I know it's looking dark. When the world falls all around you, I won't let you fall apart. Take heart. Take heart. Do you remember singing back when you were younger? He's got the whole world in his hands. Well, that's still true. I hold your family, all your friends, and all your loved ones. And even when you're barely holding on, I'm holding you. So take heart and take a breath, and let me lift that heavy weight up off your chest. And take my hand, I know it's looking dark. When the world falls all around you, I won't let you fall apart. Take heart. But I have overcome the world. Oh, in this world you will have trouble, but I have overcome the world. So take heart and take a breath, and let me lift that heavy weight up off your chest. Take my hand, I know it's looking dark. When the world falls all around you, I won't let you fall apart. So take heart, child, take heart.
Well, who would have thought when we started 2020 that we'd face such a difficult year as a nation in the world? It is unbelievable. Nobody saw this coming. And many people have got questions. They're feeling vulnerable, isolated, anxious, concerned about the future, wondering where to turn, wondering where they can have hope. Starting on June the 17th, we're going to tackle the big questions people are asking, short talks and testimonies. We're going to put them out on our YouTube channel, we're going to put them out on Facebook, and we're going to try and put them on Instagram.
Real life, real hope in lockdown.
Thank you. welcome to All Saints Church Online. Things are a little bit different at the moment, but we're still managing to meet together each week to worship and read the Bible.
Every Sunday we're going live at 9:15 and 10:45 in the morning and 6:30 in the evening. A great chance to sing, to hear God's word preached, and to enjoy fellowship together.
Then on a Tuesday we meet with our young people over Zoom. We look at a Bible passage together and continue to grow as a group in our love for the Lord Jesus Christ.
We are praying as a church, as a town, with the global church, that the name of Christ will be glorified through this time of COVID-19.
So let's jump in and explore some of the things that we've been getting up to recently.
Through Zoom, we've been able to continue our Christianity Explored course, and it means that actually in the comfort of your own home, you can get to know a little bit more about the Christian faith in an informal and friendly environment.
Our home groups are also running online too, allowing us to connect with and disciple one another from the comfort of our own sofas.
Well, our doors may be shut, but our church is very much open and alive and growing and reaching out. Join us every Sunday at 9:15, 10:45 and 6:30 via our YouTube channel or via allsaintscrowborough.org. God bless you and see you soon.
Here is the church.
Here is the steeple.
Open the doors
and see all the people.
There are approximately 85 million Christians in the worldwide Anglican Communion.
The majority of them are represented by GAFCON.
But what exactly is GAFCON? The Global Anglican Future Conference, or GAFCON, is a movement of global Anglicans within the Communion whose mission is to guard the unchanging, transforming gospel of Jesus Christ and to proclaim him to the world. GAFCON is active in 6 continents with the participation of 11 provinces led by a primate or archbishop and 7 branches. GAFCON was formed in 2008 when over 1,000 bishops, clergy, and lay leaders met in Jerusalem to restore the Bible to the heart of the Anglican Communion. Since then, 2 more conferences have been held every 5 years, and in 2018 nearly 2,000 were present. GAFCON continues to encourage a growing number of global Anglicans to proclaim Christ faithfully as they resist compromise and submit to the authority of Scripture. GAFCON is passionate about bringing the good news of Jesus Christ to all nations. For this reason, 10 global networks have been launched to share relevant knowledge and experience and coordinate in their areas of expertise. You see, GAFCON is more than a conference where delegates from around the world meet every 5 years. It is a global family of authentic Anglicans standing together to guard and proclaim the unchanging truth of God's Word in a changing world. It is a movement of like-minded, confessing Anglicans proclaiming Christ faithfully.
Well, who would have thought when we started 2020 that we'd face such a difficult year as a nation in the world? It is unbelievable. Nobody saw this coming. And many people have got questions. They're feeling vulnerable, isolated, anxious, concerned about the future, wondering where to turn, wondering where they can have hope. And of course, as Christians, we know where hope is found. It is found in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why we're launching a mission through June into July, 4 Wednesdays, starting on June the 17th. We're going to tackle the big questions people are asking, short talks and testimonies. We're going to put them out on our YouTube channel. We're going to put them out on Facebook, and we're going to try and put them on Instagram. And please, please, please think about who you can encourage to watch, to share them with, as we share the good news of Jesus Christ at this time. What an opportunity it is to speak of the hope we have in Him. The mission is called Hope 2020. It starts on the 17th of June. Look out for more information. It's a story of real lives, real hope in lockdown. Well, hello and welcome to All Saints Crowborough. My name is Steve Rees. I'm the vicar here, and it's a joy to welcome you to the service today. Just a bit of church family news to share with you. Six things at high speed. You should have got lots more information in the notice sheet on Friday, but six things to highlight. First thing, Monday night, special training evening with Helen Thorne, Biblical Counseling UK. If you signed up for that, make sure you watch the talk beforehand and you come along for discussion. Should be really useful. Wednesday night is our first Wednesday of the month, and it's our prayer meeting, but we're going to meet earlier on Wednesday, 7 till 8, for praise and prayer. Then 8 o'clock is the next episode of our series of programmes called Hope 2020, just asking and answering big questions at the moment and sharing testimonies. Watch it and think, who can I share this with? Who can I invite to watch this with me or tell about after the event? It'll be available via our YouTube channel still and our website for you to share with friends and family. Do watch that. Then Thursday we meet for prayer. Again, Friday week for prayer, Thursday 12:30, Friday 9:30 via Zoom. Then next Sunday, there's a special service happening. Our usual service is 9:15, 10:45. Also, we're going to have children's church via video for the first time next weekend. But actually, at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, we are going to be having our first ever, possibly our last, drive-in church. We have found a field just outside of Crowborough that we can use for a all-age service, 3 o'clock next Sunday the 5th. And if you'd like to come, it should be fantastic. You need to sign up via Church Suite or online, and you can book in that way and assure yourself a place. There's limited places, not enough room for everyone, unfortunately, but hopefully all those who want to come will be able to come. It'll be an all-age service with singing in our cars and prayer and a little Bible talk and lots of fun games. Why not bring along some flags to wave outside the window or scarves you can wave that we can use in our praise and our singing and also to use for games and competitions that we can play during that event. We'd love for you to come. We'd love to gather as a church family next Sunday at 3 with as many people as possible just to be encouraged at this unusual time. Well, I do hope you can join us. After this short little bit of information, Tim's going to share news of a special service coming from the 12th of July. And then also at the end of this service, you should be able to watch a little video about the big sing. Kathy wants to get as many people in the church family to record their voices singing a song that she wants to bring together in a big sing that we can play at our services on a Sunday. If you'd like to get involved, tech information after this service. Well, God bless. Have a great day. Do be in touch if we can help you in any way. Bye-bye now.
Well, hello. I wanted to tell you about our next big questions evening coming up on Sunday, the 12th of July. And we're going to be thinking together about the question, does environmentalism need God? Environmentalism is understandably slightly slipped from the headlines recently, but actually it's still a big issue for our world and it's not going to go anywhere. And so it's important we think together about this. I'm delighted to say we have Richard Buggs coming to help us think about this question. Richard is the Professor of Evolutionary Genomics at Queen Mary's University in London. He's also the Senior Research Leader for Plant Health at Kew Gardens. Currently, he's trying to save the nation's ash trees. And so alongside that, he is a committed Christian, someone that Lucy and I used to be at church with, and therefore he is ideally placed to help us think about this question. We'll have a slightly shortened Sunday service. Richard will speak, And then we hope to have a chance for question and answers after us on Zoom, both about what Richard addresses, but also a chance to ask him more broadly about the connection between being an evolutionary biologist and also a committed Christian. As always with our big questions evenings, we hope there'll be equipping for us as church family members, but also there'll be things that we're thinking about who we can invite to. Lots of people really care about the environment, don't they? And so may well be engaged with this question as we think about it together. So I hope a great outreach opportunity as well. So let me commend that to you. Our next big questions evening on Sunday, the 12th of July at 6:30 p.m. in the evening. What a very warm welcome to our Sunday evening service. My name's Tim Hines. I'll be leading our service this evening. Later on, Adam is going to be preaching as we continue our series in 1 Samuel. We've been learning lots, haven't we, from this Old Testament history book, but learning loads that is applicable to us and our lives now. And also we'll sing, we'll pray together, and there'll be a chance to chat with one another on Zoom after the service. As we begin, we're going to sing. We're going to sing, "Oh, Praise the Name."
My mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh,
Well, we come now to our time of confession. And you'll remember last week in 1 Samuel, we heard Samuel call the people to come and together to confess their sin. He called them, he said to them, if you're returning to the Lord with all your hearts, rid yourselves of the foreign gods and the Ashtaroths and commit yourself to the Lord and serve him only. And what did the people do? They assembled, they drew water and poured out before the Lord. They fasted and there they confessed, we've sinned against the Lord. Well, our rebellion against the Lord may not have been as dramatic over the last week as those Israelites. But nonetheless, we now have the opportunity together to come before the Lord and to humble ourselves before him and to confess our sins. And we'll do that using the words that will come up on the screen. Lord God, we've sinned against you. We've done evil in your sight. We're sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, after the people had come and repented before the Lord, you remember they won that great victory. And then what Samuel did, Samuel took a stone and he set it up and named it Ebenezer, saying, thus far the Lord has helped us. On our table here, we've got the cross. That's our Ebenezer stone. It's the thing we look to and remember the Lord's kindness to us, the way that he has helped us right up to the present, and our trust that he will continue to do that. Let me pray. Father, thank you so much for the Lord Jesus. Thank you for his death on the cross. That is that sign of how you have helped us. You've dealt with our sin, and we stand before you now cleansed by the blood of Jesus. Thank you that Jesus and the cross is our Ebenezer. Amen. Well, Isabel Townsend is now going to continue to lead us in prayer.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the beautiful weather that you have been blessing us with. Thank you for the area that we live in and that we are able to enjoy your creation through this time. Help us to never take for granted your world and the freedom we have to exercise. May we find times of peace and stillness as we do this. Lord, thank you for the promises we read from your word, promises of salvation, hope and life forever with you. Lord, thank you that we can come to you in prayer. Isaiah 65 verse 24 says, before they call, I will answer. While they are still speaking, I will hear. It is so easy to feel helpless in this world and as though our voice goes unheard. But Lord, your word tells us that you hear even before we call out to you. You answer in ways we could not have predicted or would not have chosen because your way is so much higher than ours. Thank you, Lord, that we can pray to you. As we think back over our week, Lord, we turn to you in repentance. We are sorry for the things we have said to people that were untrue or unkind. Lord, we are reminded in the Bible of how powerful and dangerous our tongue can be when we use it to lie or gossip. Lord, as David prays in Psalm 141, verse 3, set a guard over my mouth, Lord, keep watch over the door of my lips. We think back over the times this week where we have ignored your voice and thought that we should be in control. Lord, we are sorry for when we have turned away from you. Forgive us, Lord, for we have all sinned against you this week. Lord, we live in a scary and ever-changing world. Help us to turn to you when we feel afraid. Help us to seek your peace. I pray for those who are feeling particularly vulnerable during this time. Those who are ill, have lost loved ones, are living alone or who suffer from mental health problems. Lord, we lift them to you and ask that you would comfort them during this time. Help us to reach out to those who we know are alone who are struggling during this time. We continue to pray for our government and all those who are leading us through this pandemic. Thank you for Boris Johnson, and we pray that he would come to know you and love you. Fill our government with wisdom as we continue to fight the coronavirus and ease out of lockdown. With such big decisions taking place and so much confusion, We ask that we would continue to respect our authority as we are called to do in the Bible. Thank you for our NHS and the incredible work all of our doctors and nurses have done over the last few months. As the rest of the world begins to pick up, would you give them time of rest to recover from the last few months? We thank you for our teachers, most of whom have been working through without a half term or break with the vulnerable and key workers' children. As they welcome more children back, would you give them strength and energy to keep going? Would they continue to trust in you and find peace in your word? Lord, we thank you for everyone who has been working through this pandemic. Protect and bring them peace. Lord, your name is mighty, ruler, king, friend and father. Thank you for your unfailing love. We pray all of these things in your name. Amen. Join with me now to say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
I believe in the Son. I believe in the risen one. I believe I overcome by the power of his blood. Amen. Amen. I believe because he lives. Amen.
The reading is 1 Samuel chapter 8 verses 1 to 22. That's 1 Samuel chapter 8 verses 1 to 22. When Samuel grew old, he appointed his sons as Israel's leaders. The name of his firstborn was Joel, and the name of his second was Abijah, and they served at Beersheba. But his sons did not follow his ways. They turned aside after dishonest gain and accepted bribes and perverted justice. So all the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah. They said to him, "You are old, and your sons do not follow your ways. Now appoint a king to lead us, such as all the other nations have." But when they said, "Give us a king to lead us," this displeased Samuel, so he prayed to the Lord. And the Lord told him, "Listen to all that the people are saying to you. It is not you that they have rejected, but they have rejected me as their king. As they have done from the day I brought them up out of Egypt until this day, forsaking me and serving other gods, so they are doing to you. Now listen to them, but warn them solemnly, and let them know what the king who will reign over them will claim as his rights." Samuel told all the words of the Lord to the people who were asking him for a king. He said, "This is what the king who will reign over you will claim as his rights. He will take your sons and make them serve with his chariots and horses, and they will run in front of his chariots. Some he will assign to be commanders of thousands and commanders of fifties, and others to plough his ground and reap his harvest, and still others to make weapons of war and equipment for his chariots. He will take your daughters to be perfumers and cooks and bakers. He will take the best of your fields and vineyards and olive groves and give them to his attendants. He will take a tenth of your grain and of your vintage and give it to his officials and attendants. Your male and female servants and the best of your cattle and donkeys he will take for his own use. He will take a tenth of your flocks, and you yourselves will become his slaves. When that day comes, you will cry out for relief from the king you have chosen, but the Lord will not answer you in that day." But the people refused to listen to Samuel. "No," they said, "we want a king over us. Then we shall be like all the other nations, with a king to lead us and go out before us and fight our battles." When Samuel heard all that the people said, he repeated it before the Lord. The Lord answered, "Listen to them and give them a king." Then Samuel said to the Israelites, "Everyone go back to your own town." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
No one wants to be a fool. We spend our lives chasing after things which are the antithesis of foolishness. We long for a purpose and to be productive rather than running fool's errands. We want to be wise with our money, how we save it and how we use it, because we know that a fool and his money are soon parted. We'd like to think that we've got a degree of wisdom and experience. We don't want to be naive. Fools rush in where angels fear to tread. We strive for wisdom. We like to think that we've got common sense. But tonight's passage is sobering because it shows us to be fools. It is an uncomfortable passage because it shows us the foolishness of our sin in stark relief. You see, Samuel is getting old, and his sons, well, they're not up to the task. Dishonest gain, they're greedy for money. They accepted bribes, they've got no integrity, and they perverted justice. They're not up to the task of leading Israel. So Israel decides that the wise course of action is to ask God for a king. The conversation between Israel and God via Samuel unfolds in chapter 8, and it displays the folly of sin. The first way we see the folly of sin is in how Israel want to be like the other nations. You see, Israel were meant to be different. They were a holy nation, set apart, different, dissimilar to other nations around them. They were God's chosen, special people, special in his sight, and designed to stand out from their neighbouring countries. And like some kind of holy Hoover, they were meant to draw in people from the nations around them. It wasn't an inflected holiness. It was an infectious holiness. But just look at their request in verse 5 and then again in verses 19 to 20. Appoint a king to lead us, such as all the other nations have. We want a king over us. Then we shall be like all the other nations, with a king to lead us and to go out before us and fight our battles. It's shocking. It's tantamount to saying, we don't want to be a holy nation. We don't want to stand out. We want to be just like them. The nations have a human king. We want to be just like them. The nations have a king who fights their battles. We want to be just like them. It's shocking because Israel already had a king. And with this request, they are rejecting him. They are rejecting God. You see, that's the second way we see the foolishness of sin. Israel are rejecting a king who gives because they want a king who takes. We've seen the Lord's provision and protection of his people in chapters 1 to 7. He gives Hannah the son that she so desperately wanted. He promises the priest that the people so desperately need. He provides and protects for them during the whole saga of the Ark in chapters 4 to 7. Just last week we saw the Ebenezer being set up because the Lord has helped us. And yet Israel want a human king who will lead them and fight for them. God is clear in verse 8 that they are rejecting him, and not for the first time. Israel had a history of such foolishness, forsaking God and serving idols. Forgive me for using the expression, but like a dog returns to its vomit, so a fool repeats his folly. It's like they've lost sight of everything God has done for them in the past. And they're ignorant about what exactly having a human king will be like. And so he warns them that this king, a human king, will claim his right. Look at verses 11 to 18. This is what the Lord warns. This human king, well, he'll take your sons to be soldiers and farmers. He'll take your daughters to be perfumers, cooks and bakers. He'll take your fields and your vineyards and your olive groves. He'll take a tenth of your grain. He'll take your male and your female servants. He'll take the best of your cattle and your donkeys. He'll take a tenth of your flocks. You will be his slaves. This king that they want, a king like the nations, will take, take, take. They are rejecting the king who helps and are seeking a king who takes. It's madness. It's complete and utter folly. It's beyond comprehension, and yet we're guilty of this too. The New Testament often uses Old Testament language for Israel to describe the church. Peter nods towards Exodus when he says to scattered Christians, "But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Israel was a holy nation. It was meant to stand out and suck people in. The church is meant to be holy and declare the praises of the one who saved us. And yet, just like Israel, who fell foul of that just like them feeling, that just like them syndrome, churches can so easily look at the world around them, realise that it's hard to stand out and harder still to speak out, and so just end up wanting to be just like them. We know churches across this country, even in our own denomination, face the temptation to be like the world around them, to adopt the wants of the world and to acquiesce to the moral standards of society. Take a tour round too many towns in this country and you will see churches that have rejected holiness and live like the world. You'll see monuments to sin masquerading as churches. You'll see just like them syndrome. It's a tragedy too close to home to ignore. And so it's worth asking, All Saints Crowborough, are we ever guilty of wanting to be like the world around us? And as individuals, the folly of rejecting our King is something we are all guilty of. The way we often explain sin to children is taking the crown off of God's head and putting it on our own. As individuals, we need to ask whether we are letting God rule in our lives or whether we're taking his crown for our own. As a church, are we directed by God and his word, or do we get distracted by our own desires? Is it sobering stuff to see the folly of sin, Israel's sin and our sin, illustrated so clearly? No one wants to be a fool, but we're all guilty of the folly of sin. Wonderfully, we have a King who acts foolishly in the eyes of the world. You see, God gave Israel a king. As the book of 1 Samuel goes on, we'll see the messy reign of Saul, followed by the better, but still imperfect reign of King David. Yet wonderfully, in answering Israel's foolish request, God will provide the way of salvation through one of David's descendants, King Jesus. The way we would expect a king to treat rebels is with judgment and justice, punishment and penalty. Mighty kings show the strength of their hand against feeble rebels. But not our king. Our king shows mercy to rebellious people. Our King lavishes grace on sinners who want to swipe his crown for themselves. Our King died for those who rejected him. See, sin might be foolish, but grace looks utterly foolish in the eyes of the world. The folly of grace is there in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. The Corinthians were obsessed with intellectual pursuit. Where did you study? How many letters have you got after your name? How many books have you published? How many debates have you won? To the citizens of Corinth, and to most people in modern Britain, the cross looks foolish. To many, all the cross leaves us with is a dead king, and there's no glory or victory or hope or joy or wisdom in that, is there? Well, if the cross looks to you like foolishness, if it's unimpressive and uninspiring, then you have missed the point. More than that, you are in danger. You see, our sin, our rejection of God as King, leaves us in danger. Rebels will be punished. The Bible is clear that sinners deserve to be judged by God and to face forever in hell, a place that Jesus himself describes as a place of darkness, a place of weeping, and a place separate from and outside of the joy of heaven. The folly of sin isn't comedic slapstick, but the type of foolishness that leaves us in danger. But Jesus Christ, the Son of God, entered the world as a baby boy. And as a man, he was rejected, beaten, tortured, mocked, reviled, scorned, spat at, and nailed to a cross, and took the punishment that you and I deserve for our sins. He rose to life 3 days later and guarantees that those of us who follow him no longer have to fear hell, but have the certain and unchanging hope of heaven. If you get that, if you understand that the cross was the way that King Jesus rescued sinners, then it looks far from foolish. It's wise. It's beautiful. It's incredibly humbling. So as we come to the end of this quick look at 1 Samuel chapter 8, you should be humbled by the foolishness of your sin. It should lead us to ask some questions of our church and of us as individuals. Does All Saints Crowborough ever suffer from just like them syndrome? Are we ever guilty of wanting to be like the world around us? As a church, are we directed by God and his word, or do we get distracted by our own desires? As individuals, we need to ask whether we are letting God rule over our lives or whether we're trying to take his crown for our own. But it should also leave us humbled by his grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ shown at the cross, which seems like foolishness to some, but it's powerful to those who are being saved. We should be humble that our King would rescue rebels. Rebels like us, by dying in our place. Let's pray. Father God, thank you so much that even though our sin is foolish, the Lord Jesus Christ came in order to rescue us. Thank you that even though we are rebels, even though we want to take the crown off of your head, that the Lord Jesus Christ died to rescue rebels. Father, help us to be humbled by the fact that we are sinners. Help us to be humbled by the amazing grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. Please help us to be in awe of him. Please help us to cling to him. Please help us to follow him for the rest of our lives. Amen.
My steadfast.
Well, that brings us to the end of our service. Please do join us on Zoom now. It'll be lovely to see lots of people on Zoom, a chance to chat and encourage one another with what we've heard. But as we close now, let me lead us in prayer. Our Father, we thank you so much for meeting with us this evening. We thank you for the Lord Jesus, that he is your perfect King. Thank you for everything that we have in him. Our Father, pray that you would equip us to live as the Lord Jesus's people this week, whatever it is that we face. And we pray this for your glory. Amen. Please do join us on Zoom.
Hi, I'm Kathy, if we've not met yet. Many of us are missing singing as a congregation at the moment. And so we thought that it would be great if we could sing together virtually, praise to the Lord. On the newsletter email, there's a link that leads you to download all the right bits that you need. But I thought I'd just give you a quick chat through some of this if it makes it a little bit easier. Now you need two devices. So you need something like a laptop or a tablet or a phone or a computer. And you need one of them to listen to. So you also need a pair of headphones. So you listen, plug your headphones into one device, download the click track, and you can listen to it through one and then record yourself on the other one. So you'll also need to print out or download some music and all the lyrics, whichever you prefer, and then you're good to have a go. So have a little practice first before you hit the record button. Remember to include the clap, and because that really helps us to line up all your tracks, which is a huge job when there's going to be lots of you, I hope. And don't worry that you're not Pavarotti, nor am I. And when we mix it all together, it'll all blend in and it will just hopefully sound a bit like a Sunday morning that we're all missing. And please upload your parts to the link, which is on the how-to PDF. And by clicking the right file that you want, so if you're singing just the melody line, click melody, then click new, and then you can upload your file from there. So let's give praise to our Lord and let's sing to him together.